Reformed, which are less, they follow more modern teachings and adapt more to more modern beliefs. And Judaism isn't just a religion. It has a homeland tradition, language, and culture. It's the language of Hebrew, the homeland of Jerusalem. And it has very strong traditions that you can trace back 3,000 years. Judaism believes that the Messiah has not come. Where Christianity says that the Messiah was Jesus Christ, Jews still think the Messiah is yet to come, so we're waiting for him. And when we are alive, no one can save us from terrible sins. And terrible sins include breaking the Ten Commandments, which are outlined in the Old Testament. And I could go over them, but it'll just be a waste of time. So like murder, for example, is one of them. Or do not commit adultery, do not steal. So if you break those sins, you are basically damned. We have no hell, though. It's just purgatory and heaven. And our belief, according to the Torah, is when the Messiah does come, all Jewish souls will return to Jerusalem. Also, Jews represent 0.3% of the world, so we're not a very big population.
Thank you, panelists. All right, so for our second question, it has to do with the customs of death and dying, if there are any in respect to religion. So, for example, when someone dies, what sort of rituals does your religion carry out, such as a funeral or etc.?
First of all, Jews don't believe in cremation involving wakes or open caskets. The body should be buried as soon as possible. Not to say we do still have a service and a burial service as well, but we have what's called a shiva, which means seven, which is for 7 days after the person is buried. People go over to the relative's house and give their condolences, which I think is personally very helpful, because those 7 days are some of the worst days of your life after your loved one has died. So having friends and family come over, bringing food and gifts and just consoling you is very helpful.
So my faith focuses on burying a person after he dies. And on the deathbed, we recite the Holy Quran, which is our holy book. And we recite Tasbih and Mishkat Adhan, which is because of the purify the body with the final whistle, which is like washing the body after it dies. And every person has to wash the body and ask for like recite prayers for the sin of forgiveness. And after that, the body is buried and is buried, and then everything's done, and then that's it.
But the general idea with the whole death ritual is that you're going to aid the person who has passed on into their transition to their next form. So in the case when my grandfather passed away, we had 49 days of praying, and there is a specific sutra that is specific to the bodhisattva that is responsible for transitioning people into the afterlife, and that is what was recited for about 3 hours every day for 49 days.
Christianity doesn't have a specific ritual. Each culture kind of has different ceremonies for death. But the one thing that I guess that is in common is that at Christian funerals, it should be a celebration. It's sad because it's hard not being here on this earth with your loved ones, but we have that hope with that person we believe in Jesus that we'll see them again, that the grave isn't the final stop. So it should be a happy celebration.
As I told you before, like with the levels, the ritual changes too. The caste I follow, in that caste, like after someone, we mostly use the word expire, which is just use it in my religion. But yeah, if someone passes away or something, we tend to burn bodies within a day, and it has to be before sunsets because the day and the sunrise, when sunset like this, kind of shows positivity around the environment and stuff like that. And within that day, we would invite whoever we can, the relatives or the neighbors. And there are like a bunch of holy books that's read and a bunch of prayers before burning the body. Once we burn the body, it's usually 11 days. There's a book called Quran, which shows about the talks, the stories and folklore about hell and heaven and the life there. And there's like reading for that for at least 11 days where people like sometimes do it for 51 days too. Like you can change those numbers, but it's mostly 11. And after that prayer, you tend to feed a certain number of people, and after that you can.
So for the third question, the question will be, what is the value and or purpose of life?
That's a really hard question because I'm more of a modernized guy, so I believe in science a lot. So the value and the purpose of life, in my opinion, is like, do whatever you can and be successful. But when I talk about my religion, we really believe in karma. It's like, do good, you will get good. Whatever you give, you will get. And it's basically like helping each other and stuff like that, and mostly just karma.
The value of life, especially you, is in God's image. It's where we hold it so precious. And the purpose, we believe that God made us to be in a relationship with Him. Our purpose in life is to know God, to be loved by Him, to love Him, to glorify Him. And by knowing God, we're able to know everything else. We're able to understand the purpose of different things in our lives, where they are in relation to God.
This is a really difficult question, and I struggled with this question actually throughout my life. The purpose of life, I guess, in Buddhism would to really be to discover the truth of the universe, and additionally to discover why your consciousness exists. This is, of course, something that is very difficult, which is why reincarnation and karma exist. So that you get several tries to understand or try to understand the purpose of your existence and what you need to do to find complete truth, complete serenity, so that you can ultimately leave the cycle of samsara and enter the complete bliss known as nirvana.
So for us, life is like a period of self-exaltation and present for like the next world. And like if we develop these, we'll be exposed to like all things and blessings like heaven. And life is pure, and then we try to like, life is like a lesson, like an example for us, like, you know, for prayers and like follow our teaching says so that we can get a better living after death.
To be specific in this one, according to the book of Ecclesiastes, which is in the Tanakh, which is referred to as the Jewish Bible, which is different than the Old Testament, the purpose of life is to honor God and obey His commandments. In addition to the Ten Commandments, Jews also have 613 mitzvot, or mitzvahs, that they're supposed to follow and embody through life. Thank you. So for our fourth question, I'm going to be asking, what is the role of suffering, if any, in each of your respective religions?
The presence of suffering in the world insofar as it seems to contradict the notion of an all-benevolent and powerful God. Essentially, we don't understand why God does bad things to good people. An example of this would be the Holocaust, where, if you don't know what that is, 6 million Jews were systematically murdered, which was a third of the Jewish population at the time. And I've talked to many Holocaust victims, and they still retain their Judaism. And if your religion can survive through that, you can survive through anything.
We believe that suffering will reduce the chances of reincarnation, and it is given by God and we need to accept it. And suffering makes us like near to God. And in our lifetime, like when we do something wrong, God will punish us. suffer. So, like, we need to accept that.
We believe that as long as you are in the six cycles of samsara, that you're going to be suffering. The whole idea behind life and existence is suffering. Everything you do in life, even if it's happy, ultimately ends in suffering because nothing lasts forever. We believe that everything is fleeting. And the idea that you cannot get what you want is a form of suffering. In order to escape suffering, we need to see that everything around us, for example, I'm just gonna randomly choose you. We seem to be different people. We look very different, and we probably act very differently. However, Buddhists believe that everything at the core, trees, plants, humans, animals, everything is in the essence the same thing. So that's really hard to see. And to me, this doesn't, our differences don't seem like an illusion. But in order to understand this, or the moment to understand this, able to truly understand this, then you will be able to escape suffering.
God isn't the source of evil and suffering. He created the world perfectly. Like, it was a perfect place. There was no suffering. There was no sin. But because of sin, and because he gave us free will, there is suffering. There's terrible things that happen. But it's not evil, power of evil and God, they're not evils. God has control over suffering, and he's able to use it to show us who he is and what his character is. And so a lot of the times, that is one of his biggest tools, is when we hit rock bottom, then we have to look up to him, and it forces us to rely on him. But the tragedies and stuff, they're not from God. He just uses them for good.
In a coin, there's a head and a tail. So pretty much like that, in Hinduism, if you have a life, you will also have suffering. It's a part of life, and that's what you learn it from. Even in like folklore, even God has suffered. There are a bunch of stories of their suffering and stuff, and after every story, there is a moral. So you learn from suffering.
Realm of bioethics, which are very controversial due to the fact that they tend to challenge orthodox beliefs of religions. So first we're going to go down asking two questions. One being, how does your faith view bioethics? For example, that would be physician-assisted suicide, euthanasia, contraception, abortion, organ donation, transplantation, etc. And then following up with that, I would like each of the panelists to respond with, do you agree with these stances, why or why not?
In Hinduism, we have a holy book called Gita, which is pretty much like Bible, and it has all these stories and whatever they believe or the rules of God. But nothing is mentioned about physician or surgery, but there's this idea of karma, which I mentioned before. It's like, if it's for the good path, you will be benefited. It's more about positive and negative energy. If your action creates positive energy, it's good. If your action doesn't create positive energy, it's more negative, then you know.
Because Christians believe that all people are made in God's image, all life is extremely valuable to us, and we don't believe that we have the right to end any life, and all these issues is that we put life very high up. It's extremely precious to us all, and so it's not our place to decide to take a life, human life.
That's a very difficult question because there are so many aspects to the topic of bioethics. I would say in Buddhism, it's very much similar to what Vic had said earlier about generating positive energy. Generally, we don't believe in killing, so the idea of abortion generally does not stand well with most Buddhists. But there is very little discussion or even controversy over the ideas of contraception even, because ultimately a lot of people who get really high up into practicing Buddhism practice abstinence, so contraception is not really even something to talk about. As for suicide, I think there are generally stories about suicide being frowned upon, because when you enter into the other realm, other existence, some Buddhists, I don't know about my family, but some Buddhists tend to believe that you would have to keep performing your suicide act for many, many, many days until someone else commits suicide. It's very strange and I don't really understand. But in general, nothing really clashes so much with my beliefs, I guess. I don't believe in irresponsible abortion per se, but I would say if, you know, you're gonna die from it, if you're gonna die from labor, then you're gonna have to make a choice. And I wouldn't blame you for any choice that you make.
So Islam does not allow for abortion, and he thinks that it's a sin, and it's not at all accepted. And in terms of suicide, it's a sin, and that you don't have any right to take her own life away. And if a person attempts suicide, her soul like will have been supposed to be merged with God's light. And in terms of organ donation, it can only be allowed once a person is not during his or her prison.
Assisted suicide and euthanasia are both forbidden by Jewish law. Contraception is allowed and abortion is okay in certain situations, but this depends on your denomination of Judaism, where the Orthodox Jews are a lot more specific with it and they don't allow a lot of that. I'm speaking for myself and I happen to be a conservative Jew, and conservatives are a lot more modernized and liberal to these views. And do I agree with that stance personally? Yeah, I agree, everything should be allowed. It's modern.
Thank you for answering those challenging questions. So next I want to ask, does your religion distinguish between killing and letting die?
According to the Torah, it's the same.
There doesn't tend to be a distinction, but I think depending on what type of Buddhism that you practice, there may be a distinction. There are some people who don't want to be saved. For example, if somebody is suffering from illness and they do not want to be resuscitated, your choice to not resuscitate them is not considered killing them.
There's a difference, which you kind of said, with physician-assisted suicide, that's against our beliefs. But I think with like someone who has terminal cancer and they're done taking treatment, I don't necessarily think that's a sin. But we're not to take life. There's a difference between killing and just letting death happen.
There is a very fine line between killing and letting someone die. And again, it's all come back to the idea of karma and positive and negative energy. And the other way of that playing plays the role in the situation.
Okay, and the last question I have for you folks is, are there any parting words that you each have for us to take away with about your religion?
The only thing I would say about my religion is that if you're really interested, there's books on Gita, Rita, it's a lot of information in it. And if someone wants to follow Hinduism, I mean, they don't really have to go through the rituals and stuff. It's mostly because it's all about karma. If you believe in karma, you're a part of your is already Hindu.
Okay,
Yes, with death, specifically, Christianity has good news concerning death. Death's a scary thing. It's something we really try and push down, not think about a lot. But like I talked about at the beginning, it's something we don't have to be afraid of. Jesus has made a way for us. He's that offer is for everyone. He died for every single person. And so when we accept him, believe that he died for us, death's just a step. It's not something we need to fear, and it's a comfort.
I think by the very essence, Buddhism is not actually considered a religion. It's just considered a way of life, a way of carrying yourself. The idea behind Buddhism, really at the very core, is to do good things, spread good energy, don't do anything to hurt yourself or to hurt others. Generally, Buddhists are very open people. I think we don't deny the existence of other deities or other religions. And for those who struggle to reconcile science and religion, I think not everything needs to be taken literally. There are metaphors probably in all the scripture, including all the sutras or the mantras that you see in Buddhism. So that's just my prayer.
Judaism is that before you die, you should do good things because you won't have a chance.
All right, let's give them a round of applause. For you. Now we're going to post a little Q&A, so any of the folks out here have a question?
Use it anyway. He's bringing the mic to you.
Specifically to the part that the mother is dying. but I don't think I really have a right to answer for all of these on these biological issues. I will just say that it's the idea of whether or not you are generating good energy or bad energy, and if your actions are considered responsible. Everything eventually after you get, after it happens, is a collection of karma. And sometimes, per se, if a child is aborted, it might be something about owing the person who is their mother in this life something in a past life in which they would have to give up their life for. But I really don't have the power to answer a lot of these bioethical issues. Those realms of heaven, you can just get to depending on how much good karma you accumulated throughout your lives. And some sects of Buddhism believe that in order to get to nirvana, you need the aid of certain Buddhas or Bodhisattvas that you follow. For example, in Pure Land Buddhism, some people believe that you actually need the guidance of either